Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Prospect Street United Methodist Church. Do we have any guests with us today? Any guests?
My son is here, and he's been staying with me the last few days, and as I leave today, I'm leaving him a list of chores to do for the next few days. Would you like me to turn my mic on?
Okay.
My son is here today, and he hasn't come up here for quite a while, so he's been staying with me this week, and I'm going to leave him a list of chores to do this week while I'm gone.
Poor Dominic. Okay, let's take this time and greet one another. Okay, if everyone could please make sure that you sign the red pads at the end of the pews and pass it down for the next person, that would be great. Let us prepare our hearts and minds for worshiping God as we silently listen to the prelude.
Thank you.
Please stand if you are able and let's say the call to worship together. Then Jesus went around, teaching from village to village. These were his instructions: to take nothing for the journey except a staff. No bread, no bag, no money in your belts. Wear sandals, but not an extra tunic. Let us say the opening prayer together. You are a God of grace and mercy, so we ask you to forgive us for all the times we are led astray. You have given us the tools we need to stay on the straight and narrow path, but we are also easily distracted. Give us strength and courage for the journey ahead. Amen.
By the Lord of sea and sky, I have heard my people's cry, all who dwell in darkest sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make their darkness bright. Who will bear my love?
will break their hearts of stone. Give them hearts for love alone. I will speak my word to them.
Whom shall I send?
By the Lord of wind and flame, I will tend the poor and lame. I will set a feast for them. My hand will sing.
Finest bread I will provide.
Sorry. Isn't it wonderful to have Chris and Sabina come and share with us? And you don't have the baby with you. Oh, she's up there. I figured she wouldn't be far away. So thank you so much for coming. And Jim, you have to be so proud. And now it's time for us to turn back to God, to give God back a part of everything he has given to us. So as the ushers come, we will take up our morning tithes and offerings.
Shall I come before the Lord and bow myself before God on high? Shall I come before him with birth? sovereigns, shall I come before him with yielding calves? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I give him my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O man, he has shown you what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly?
We thank you, Father, for everything that you have given to us and for the opportunity that we have to give back to you, to serve those you love, to serve our community, our nation, and all those on the earth. So thank you, Lord, for your gracious kindness to us. In your name we pray. Amen. So, this week, it's back to school, right? Oh, good. I'm glad you're happy. And do I hear some amens from parents, grandparents out there? Yes. My neighbor is raising his two grandchildren, and I went over to help them empty a pool yesterday, and I said, so, are the kids excited to go back to school? He said, I don't know, but I am. So, that was good, huh? All right, today I have a task for us, okay? You're thinking about going back to school. Do you all have new book bags? I know yes. You don't. So, yes. And new things. Isn't it cool to have new things going back to school? Yep, you what? Sparkly folders. Wonderful. Well, at least the boys won't steal them, so that's the truth. I need a helper. Would you be willing to help me today? Can you come and help me? Come on over here. Okay? Can we put your monkey on my lap? Can you put him on my lap? Okay, we'll let him watch, okay? Turn this way. Okay, all right, cool. Okay, I want you to hold this bag. Can you do that? Well, yes, you're a pro, huh? Now, in our lives, and we start getting older, we do more and more things, don't we? And as we go back to school, we have to have books. So we're going to put going back to school. This is a book that represents us going back to school. Okay? All right. And then now we have to get back into routine, right? So we get up and we have a good breakfast before we go into school. This is our good breakfast. Okay? Gosh, you have strong muscles. And then we go to school, and when we come home, what are some things you do when you come home?
Homework.
Homework. That's a good one. I'm glad you said that. So there's our homework in the bag. You okay? Oh my goodness. Is it getting heavy? No? Are you sure? Okay. What are some other things we do? Play games on tablet or whatever. Very good. Oh, gosh. Ooh. You still going? Is it getting a little heavy? Uh-huh. Yes. Would you like some help? Would you like some help? Yes? Okay. Well, would you be willing to help her? Come on up here. How about you take one handle right here? Can you hold that? Oh, there. Is that a little bit better when you when if he's helping you? Okay. Something else that you do? Like, after
have fun.
All right, playing outside. We're going to put that in there. Oh, gosh, it's getting full, isn't it?
Yeah.
Are you still okay, guys?
Yeah.
Emma, what is something you do, an activity after school?
Eat food.
Oh, well, that's a good one. We have to eat food.
Fire truck.
Oh, that is a fire truck, yes. Whoa, how full is our bag? Is that getting heavy? It sure is, isn't it? Even with two of you. All right, I'm going to let you put that down for a minute. What if we took some of those things out?
It wouldn't be heavy.
It wouldn't be heavy. You are absolutely right. It would be easier to hold, wouldn't it? Especially if there's two of us. You know, sometimes in our lives, we do so many things. We get involved in so many activities. And we hold on to sin in our lives. And it becomes too heavy for us to hold. So, when we give our sin away to God, those were the activities we took out earlier. Whoop, hold on to it. Okay? The bag gets even lighter as we give our sin to God. And now, it's not heavy. Exactly right. That's what happens when we give our burdens to God. Okay? So I want you to remember that. Thank you for your help. Let's give them a round of applause. Excellent. Okay, we're going to pray. Okay? Let's put our hands together. Oh Lord, we thank you for these children and for the message today. And we pray that their sin burdens can be taken away, and that they can love you with all their heart. In your wonderful name we pray. Amen. And there are papers on the back for you to get, okay?
Thank you.
Janet and Bob Lucas wish to thank everyone for their cards, their prayers, and their kindness during her recovery from hip surgery. And I think she'll be going home really soon here. It's absolutely wonderful. Another joy, Haley Augenstein, who is the granddaughter of Bob and Anita Bacon and a cousin of Nancy Kimball, won Miss Popcorn last night. How awesome is that? Congratulations. And so now to our prayer concerns. Vera Edwards, who is Bill O'Neill's sister, has been diagnosed with cancer. So we want to remember all of them. John Rao's brother, Larry Rao, has been struggling with his health. So let us remember him. Keith Haas asks us to pray for Vicky Gruber, who had two heart attacks last week, but is recovering quite well. Brian and Deb Mailer ask us to pray for Loretta Mailer, who is Brian's stepmother. She has a possible virus and was admitted to Marion General. Lynn Claiball asks us to pray for Cliff. I can't remember what he said. What was the name he said? Do you have that down there? Yes, Spawn. That's what it was. He has emphysema. Yes, it's spelled funny. You Americans have funny spellings. I don't know how it went. So. Oh, yeah, I am American now, aren't I? Yes. And Fred, thank you. Good grief, my brain is gone. Fred Robinson's classmate, Mary Lee George, who we've been praying for quite a while, passed away last Thursday. So let us remember their family. I would ask you to pray for my son, Dominic. Well, pray for him in general, but also he is going to be teaching full-time at Sydney Fairlawn. And he now needs to find a place to live over in Sydney. So we went over there one day this week and found absolutely nothing. But finally, he started getting some leads. So he's going to look at some places tomorrow. Please pray that he can find a place, move into it, and that it's at a price that he can afford. So we leave this afternoon, or well, later today, for England. So I would pray for your travel mercies for our trip. Let's go to the Lord in prayer today. Oh Lord, our God, we come before you this morning. We lay down our burdens before you so that we don't have to carry along heavy bags. You have heard our requests for prayer and healing and comforting. Come down on those families who have recently lost loved ones, including Joe Craig. We pray for those who mourn their loss. Lord, we pray for those who may be nearing the end of their death, even as we speak. Give the families comfort, peace, and hope in life everlasting. Lord, we lift up to you all those who are in hospital, who will be facing surgery, recovering from surgery. And we think of our shut-ins, Lord, and ask you to give them a special dose of the Holy Spirit today so they can feel your love for them. We think of our country, and we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit on our leaders, on our military. Help them govern and lead through your authority, not their own. And Lord, we remember those who are less fortunate than ourselves, the homeless, the hungry, the thirsty, those who do not know Christ, those who have turned away, those who are incarcerated, and those who are caught in the web of any addiction. Lord, you love all your people. Help us to see them through your eyes. And now we lift up to you the prayer that your Son taught us to say. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as it was to trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Just in case you do not know, Joe Craig's funeral, well, the viewing will be here on Thursday night from 4 till 7. The funeral then will be at 10:30, also here in the sanctuary. And then there will be a dinner afterwards, so down in the basement, by our wonderful ladies who do an awesome job preparing that meal. Pastor Joe is back from England, and I said to him, I sent him a text and said, welcome back, you have a funeral next week. I was there for Joe, and she had such a peaceful passing. What a joy that was. In fact, and I know Pastor Joe's going to be sharing this, but we had our leadership team meeting on Thursday night, and afterwards I knew I wanted to go back to the hospital. I'd been there, but go back to see her. And as I was leaving this building, Erica texted me, are you coming to see Joe? And I said, yes. And then as I drove over there, I thought, I bet she's near the end. And she was on the fourth floor, and I'm trying to get in more steps, so I walked up the steps, and I was good, but just a little bit winded, obviously, after walking up all those flights of stairs. And I walk into the room, and Ralph had just moved to her bed and was holding her hand, and he said, Pastor, you'd better pray. She's going quick. She may have taken 4 or 5 more breaths. But as I prayed, and Ralph thought I was so overcome by her death, but actually I was just trying to breathe through the prayer. But we prayed, and I said, Amen, and looked at Joe, and she went, it was as if she was saying, Amen. And we were talking, and Ralph said, she's gone. And I said, I'll get the nurse, because I know they have to check. And before I could turn around to get her, Joe went one more time, because she had to have the last word. And for all of those who knew her best, that is exactly what she would have said. And Ralph was delighted with that. So we will cherish her memory here and all the things that she has done in this church.
you are able, for the reading of the scripture from Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1 through 3. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. This is the word of God from long ago for the people of God today. Thanks be to God.
O Lord, be present with us now, and let us hear and feel your presence. What words do you have for each of us that we can take away from the service that will get us through this week? In your wonderful name we pray. Amen. I've been spending off and on during the week time to start packing. I took over one of the spare rooms with the big bed. And as I've been doing washing and just thinking of things, I've been putting them on that bed. And the bed's got fuller and fuller and fuller. And at one point during the week, I thought, wait, where is this article of clothing? Oh, I put it upstairs. I need that. So I went and got it. So last night came the big test. I looked at all the stuff that was on the bed and thought, I cannot possibly take all of this. It may not fit in my suitcase, but it may go over the weight limit. And I want to be under the weight limit so that I can pack my case to the full limit to come back. You ever felt that? When you go on a trip, have you ever packed more than you actually will need? We've all been joking, but my youngest, Noelle, takes everything and the kitchen sink when she goes away. I have reminded her, the weight limit is 40 pounds, Noelle. It's actually 50. And she told me, I looked it up, Mom. It's 50. And I don't, no doubt today her case will weigh 49.9 pounds. We put things in and then think, no, I really don't need to take that much, and take them out. But we have to watch that weight limit. But then when we arrive somewhere, we get all this stuff, and when we get back to the airport, we're willing to pay an extra fee for a heavy suitcase. It even has a great big label on it in big letters that says, heavy. I've had a few of those. Or better still, you could buy another case and then put even more in it. But you have to pay for that extra weight. Today, you can buy suitcases that are almost as big as I am. But eventually, you must make that decision. What are you going to put in that suitcase? What weight do you want to carry? Well, just like the illustration with the kids, message. That's how it is with our lives. We get involved in so much stuff today. Our responsibilities, our own problems, everybody else's problems, family issues, health issues, financial issues. We carry them around with us all the time. And that doesn't even touch our day-to-day regular issues. Or the guilt, the anger, the bitterness, and the sin that we hold on to and pack into this suitcase of life. Maybe it is time for all of us to take a deeper look inside, to see really what we don't need to pack in there. The things that are weighing us down and causing us to carry a much heavier load or burden than we really need to. After all the weddings and activities this summer, and after everyone had left, I took a deep sigh of relief. It's over. And then depression hit. Came very slowly. I got right back into doing all sorts of things, and I didn't even realize what was going on. Some old behaviors began to rear their ugly head. Have you ever experienced that? But I did not realize it was happening. But as God would have it, about 2 weeks into this, the devotion I was doing had us read the story of Nathan and David. Do you remember that story? David had stayed behind and hadn't gone to battle. He had seen Bathsheba and slept with her, and she was going to have his baby. And then he called Bathsheba's husband home and tried to have him go to sleep with his wife so that the blame would be shifted to him, but he wouldn't do that. So then David committed the terrible sin of having Uriah killed. I've always read that story and thought, how could David not know that? So God sends along Nathan the prophet, who tells David a story about a rich man who takes the poor man's sheep to have for a meal to offer his guests. And at the end of the story, David says, "Who is that man? We need to find him and kill him, for he has sinned." And Nathan turns to the king and says, "You are that man." I read that scripture and realized that sin had snuck up on me the way sin does. Every single one of us needs Nathans in our life, don't we? To point out the sin, to point out our behaviors, to point out the things we're doing too much of or not enough. Well, that was me. But have you ever been there? It was time to lessen the weight of guilt, sin, and maybe even some activities. So how do we do that? It's easy to say, hard to do. We could choose to do nothing about that and take the sermon today and leave here thinking, well, that was nice. Yep, I agree with it, but I'm not going to do anything about it. And you'll leave here, and you'll move further and further away from God, and your bag of life will become heavier and heavier and heavier. Or you could choose to look to the scriptures where we find our solution to this problem today. First of all, the writer of Hebrews describes life as a race. That is so right. Sometimes we live in a rat race, don't we? It never stops, and we are constantly moving forward. We cannot go back, and we can't stay still. We're moving forward, but to what? The scripture tells us that we do not have to be alone because we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And we have a new person who's joined that cloud, Joe Craig, this week. I'm a little nervous because I know if I say something wrong, I do something wrong, I can just imagine Joe's going to be standing there kicking me in the rear end right now. Pixar has a new movie out called Coco. Has anybody seen it here? It is absolutely fantastic, and it's on Netflix. I would suggest you watch it. It's a story about Day of the Dead that the Spanish and Mexicans celebrate. It's a story of a little boy who thinks that his ambitions are more important than family. And he actually crosses over to the other side and meets his ancestors. He learns how important it is to have a cloud of witnesses who are his ancestors surrounding him. And that is what we have. We're never alone. We have those forerunners of the faith around us. In fact, we are part of that cloud for one another. In the children's sermon, when the bag got heavier and heavier and heavier, it took two of them. And I don't know if you could see, but their muscles were bulging to hold up those. I was surprised they could have so many books in there. That's how it is with our lives if we don't share with one another. Life goes too fast. It's too busy to do it alone. The second thing the writer says, he reminds us that Jesus really led a simple life. Think about it. He was born in a stable. He didn't have a home. No mortgage payments. How awesome is that? He didn't have a wardrobe. He didn't have to keep up with the latest robes. And he had no possessions. So in Mark 6, which was our call to worship this morning, he says to his disciples when he sends them out for the first time, take nothing for the journey. Only the essentials. Why? Because Jesus was saying, leave behind everything that distracts you from following me. Leave behind your livelihood. I want you to trust other people. Leave your community. Leave your obligations and the things that you are attached to. Rely on God. Trust others in the faith. And then he reminded them to travel light. Both light in weight, getting rid of all the things that burden us, but also to be the light of Jesus Christ wherever we go. And then the third thing the scripture tells us is to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. When you run a race, if you take your eyes off the finish line, you're going to stumble and slow down and maybe even fall. I know, I've done that. You got to keep your eyes at the finish line. Jesus knew hardships. He knew the temptations that we experience. He knew things that would distract us. He knew what it was to have desires in this life. And yet, when he knew he was going to face the cross, his focus was beyond the cross on the glory that was promised for him. And so the writer reminds us, keep your eyes fixed on Jesus. Because when you have your eyes fixed on that heavenly home that Jesus is preparing for each one of us, life will be so much simpler. And we will be better witnesses of Jesus Christ. And finally, he says, when you do keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, you are prevented from being discouraged or giving up. So what's in your life suitcase right now? Is it too heavy to carry alone? What distracts you away from keeping your eyes fixed on Jesus? What could you take out of your life suitcase to make the burden of life heavier? What do you need to give to God that maybe you've held on to a long time? Or what activities do you just need to simply give up because they distract you from God? What sin, behaviors, tasks, involvements weigh you down? Lighten your load, and your light for Christ will shine even brighter. And as I had chosen this passage and was packing last night, my suitcase weighs half the amount that Noel's will. Because it was a lesson to me. What do I really need? And how, in a land that now is turning away from God in England, how can I be the light of Christ to my family, to my friends, and to all those I will meet? How can you do that in your life's journey? Before we pray, Terry has asked if he can have the floor so he can pray. And as he comes up, I just want to remind you about something. You all know that I'm going to be gone for 3 Sundays. And many of you may have thought, yoo-hoo, we've got 3 Sundays off. Wrong. And I'm standing here before you saying that. I know that's a tendency. But who do you worship? God or me? It better not be me, because I'm going to fail you. You need to be here to support those who have been called to speak in my absence. Jerry Marquis will be here next week. He needs all the help you can give him. And then Charlene will bless us with a message the following week. And then Terry will be speaking on September the 2nd. And I will be watching the videos. And I'm going to ask Ben to swing around the congregation so I know who's here and who isn't. But please, come, because our church needs the support and we need God.
Can you sit down here, Pastor Therese?
Yes.
I want to invite all that who would like to come down and lay hands on Pastor Therese with me.
And also Karen, she's going with me, so you need to get up here. You need prayer because you're going with me.
All that are able to, please come down.
Why don't you please come up in the middle so people can come around those sides.
We'll come up to you.
Come on. Don't it come in.
Come right on. And as we gather around Pastor Therese, we are so blessed and so thankful that we have you in our lives. You are so wise beyond our time here, and we're so thankful for you. And as we pray, Heavenly Father, we give thanks for this time that we have together to send Pastor Therese off on her vacation, a holiday well-deserved, Lord. She has waited years for this opportunity, and now it is time. Lord, we want you to watch over them on her journey back to her first home, London, England. Lord, we ask that as she goes forward and keep her from and her family from all danger, misfortune, temptation. Grant them a peaceful, successful, fun-filled time as they reunite old friendships and have fun with the family. I pray that they enjoy every moment of their time away and will be relaxing in the beauty of your time and your creation. And bring them back home safe, sound, refreshed, and renewed again. Lord, we give thanks and praise in the glory of your name. In the name of Jesus, amen.
Amen. Amen. God bless you. Now you can remain standing as we sing our final song.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
Thank you.
I think there should be an extra line on the end of that wonderful hymn, and don't take it back, because that's what we do. Let us pray. O Lord, as we go forth from here, our burden is lightened because we've given it to you. Don't let us take it back. And Lord, show us and lead us how to be the light of Christ as we keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. Go before us, behind us, beside us. In the name of God the Father, Jesus the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we pray, and all God's children say, Amen. Amen.